Lemon Amiga presents the top 50 greatest Amiga racing games. Sit back and enjoy the show.
Hi there, welcome to the top 50 greatest Amiga racing games of all time. And this was voted for by fans on the Lemon Amiga forum.
Those darn moonshiners are at it again!
If you thought there aren't that many racers in this season of Lemon Reviews, that's because I'd planned this for a whole year. The forum message went up there in July 2014 and a whole group of us got together and voted for our top 50, and this series of 10 shows will showcase that selection.
Hey there, I'm Ike. Watching out for Fat Sam the Sheriff is a full-time job. Come on, Billy Joe, let's get this moonshine moving!
The first game on our list is Moonshine Racers, developed by Pigstar Software and released by Millennium in 1991. And this is a rear-view driving game. Other games we narrowly missed out on the list include Nigel Mansell's World Championship and some other great games like that, but this one only just made it in there. And this game will be reviewed at some point in the Lemon Amiga Play Guides and Reviews this season, but you can see the aim of this game is simply to drive, like most driving games, from A to B and avoid all the sagebrush piling up on the road and also those other drivers, in this case Moonshine Racers, who are trying to beat us to the speakeasy at the end of each level. And you can see each level has a variety of jumps and it's a little bit like Chase HQ. Only this game flows a little easier and a bit smoother than Chase HQ, and is a bit more drivable as well. Although at this early stage, without any upgrades, we don't have any tyres or nitro boost in this thing yet, but we can upgrade those at the end of each level. In this case, I managed to make it in front of all those guys, as you can see a 1 under the clock, and that means I get 4 bonus, and we're on to the next stage. Completing the mission in first, we will gain $100, and we can spend that $100 on anything we like. Let's just buy ourselves some tyres, because those tyres are only 75, and they will help us grip. And we can buy front tyres and rear tyres, and both parts of an engine, both parts of a turbo as well, and little odds and ends which will help us concentrate, like the tobacco gives us extra grip and concentration, and little fur dice and things like that. But you can see we cannot afford much at this stage. Let's just buy what we can, some tobacco and part of a supercharger, and we'll also select the music from this menu as well.
Come on, Bill Joe, let's get this moonshine moving.
Gameplay is almost like a movie, and you will get captions appearing from your co-driver and also your boss telling you what to do, and also a radio operator who will be looking out for the police for us, And if we drive too fast in this game, it won't be long before the police catch up. You can see the police dog also has a caption. And if the police manage to pull us over, that's a drain on our time. You can see we are currently second at the moment, and we have to keep in front of all those other guys. That's the leader, we are now first. And in the top corner, you can also see a rudimentary map and an indication of our oil pressure. If we are driving too fast and driving over those obstacles, the oil pressure will rise, and if it bursts out of the top, then that's a blown engine. And we have a number of blown engines in this level. As long as we make it to the finish, we don't have any lives to speak of. So hopefully, if we can make it to the end in one piece, avoid all this traffic, then we'll get our reward.
That's a mighty fine delivery you brought there.
Back we go to the shop, and we have another 100 to spend. So we could upgrade the tyres at this point, but looking at these prices, 200 for that engine, sometimes it's best to save that cash, and then you can go for the bigger, better upgrades later on. So that's precisely what I'm doing as we move on to a brand new level with a brand new sky, all new graphics, and all new obstacles to avoid, of course. Unfortunately, it is not possible to have music and sound effects playing together, but you can switch those over mid-game from the shop, and the music in this game is very well done, very appropriate, and the graphics seem a little bit jumpy and jerky, but at the same time, when we do get those power-ups and the best engines, then the graphics are quite smooth. You can see we blew our engine, and moving over rocks and pitfalls in the road will definitely blow that engine. And sometimes when you see that overheating, it's best to gear down to first gear and let that cool off and then continue. Of course, if we drive off the road and our engine blows up, then we'll lose a lot of places. And if we lose places enough to lose money, then we won't have enough money for the upgrades to progress. You can see the controls are very slip-slidey at this point, even with brand new sets of tyres. And even with the full tyres, this hunk of junk doesn't really move that quickly on the road. The current score for Moonshine Racers on the Lemon Amiga database is currently 46%. And I think it deserves a 6 out of 10, but that was game number 50. At number 49, we have the arcade conversion of Power Drift, developed by Software Studios and released by Activision in 1989. And one of the best aspects is the music and the sound effects, particularly the title music on this game. See, my Win UAE emulation is actually struggling with the screen centering, but hopefully you can see, just like Super Hang-On, we can change the sensitivity from low, medium to high, and we can use a joystick or a mouse in this game. And by moving left and right, we can choose one of the 5 sets of tracks that we can participate in, and when we press fire, when the arrow is just under the player that we want, then that player will take control of that vehicle. And in this game, what we have to do is to complete circuits, and you can see huge piles left and right. They should be avoided, of course, and the track lowers and raises itself around all these circuits, so there are quite some elevation changes and quite some dodging maneuvers to be undertaken. And as we go over the line, we get to hear some great voice sound effects, and when those graphics disappear, you can see the frame rate takes a huge jump. And this game varies between very slow and incredibly quick.
Third lap.
Unlike the Commodore 64 version, it is not a breeze to overtake all these other guys, and there is only just enough room in that road for 2-lane traffic. If you touch anything whatsoever, you'll be crashing out and going off, and just like that, it's very quick to recenter the car back on track, and that's a good thing because you'll be crashing off in this game wildly. Graphics are just about the right size from the arcade, and I really love the arcade music and the arcade sound effects, and it's great that this game actually gives us a great feeling of action until the game actually starts, and then virtually anything you touch will make you crash out. And if you stay on the right lines and avoid all the other drivers, of course, if you are perfect, then it's possible to continue, but look at that, it is possible to create some wild maneuvers. And unfortunately, the controls leave something to be desired, and the jerky frame rates do not help one little bit. So there is something considerably wrong with this game. I don't know what it is, but it is not fun whatsoever.
Final lap.
Perhaps the best aspect is the voice sound effects saying final lap, reducing the player to stitches when they go across the line. But apart from that, there is nothing very funny about this game. Each course has five stages which are very different, and they mimic the arcade, of course, they try to at least, and like I said, even the C64 version was more playable than this, and unfortunately the car choice doesn't make much difference, neither does the driver, and you are at the mercy of all these roadside obstacles, and if you do not slow down and gear down at precisely the right point, you will be going off, and there's nothing worse than continually going off in this game. Surely a racing game shouldn't rely on luck over judgment, and when the player is actually driving very well, it shouldn't actually be a miracle. But in this game it is, and some fun can be enjoyed as long as the player is an absolute perfectionist at this game. Power Drift currently has a rating of 47% on the Lemon Amiga database, and in the Lemon Amiga forum vote, it gained enough votes to rank this number 49. Greatest Amiga racing game number 48 needs no introduction. It's Turbo Outrun, developed by ICE and released by US Gold in 1990. The arcade, by pressing fire, we can choose between automatic and manual gearbox, and it's probably best to go for manual, although I always select automatic. In Turbo Outrun, we must get from one side of America to the other using a Ferrari F40, you can see the classic shopping trolley rear wing, there it is in full boost mode. And in full boost we can get some frame rates out of this game, but in normal driving mode the frame rates are choppy to say the least. Added to that, we also have questionable collision detection. You can see I'm well over the road here, but somehow I go off. Looking at that in slow motion, I'm well over the road and now I'm off. So that's questionable collision detection in anybody's book, and I don't really appreciate that in an Amiga game. So you can see, finally, we're off the first level and we don't have to put up with much loading in this game because this is the WHD load version, but loading between levels is an absolute nightmare, not as bad as the C64, but you can see all it has done is loaded a new graphical set into the machine. It's the same highway, just with different graphics. And we gain at least two audio soundtracks in this game, which is no big deal because those are pretty terrible. As sound effects are also quite terrible, and it sounds like we're grinding rocks rather than driving a Ferrari. By driving over the water, that's supposed to decrease our overheating turbo so that we can use that, and we didn't use that in time, and that means we need to use up a continue, and that's absolutely ridiculous. And this game isn't particularly hard as long as you don't hit anything, but of course hitting things in this game is definitely one of those things which has to be mastered. This is not Lotus Esprit, you can't just expect to get around these corners in one piece, and it's so easy to veer off that road as we've seen. Also be racing against a guy in a Porsche, and yes, I do pronounce that Porsche because to my mind Porsche is a girl's name, but that thing is trying to beat us to the line, and if we beat that to the line, then our girlfriend should hopefully stay with us instead of decamping to the other side. And on the arcade version we actually got an animation of that, but before we get to see that, we'll have to win this section of the race. That means more painfully slow loading on the disc. And even with this WHD load version, they haven't actually cut out those load times, they've kept those wait states in. At first glance, the graphics may seem even arcade quality, particularly on still screenshots. And I remember seeing this in magazines and thinking that the Amiga had an arcade game on tap. Unfortunately, as you can see, the playability is beyond a joke. And yes, you can complete this game, and I think I've completed the Amiga version pretty easily. And all you have to do is keep boosting precisely at the right point and avoid everything. And if you don't do that, it's a pretty boring and repetitive game. I don't know about you, but these tremendously long loading times for this game is an absolute joke, and Outrun Europa was head and shoulders above this. Basically, it did not pause for half an hour between each level. We simply fell off the road at that point, and that meant we had to gear down and try again to keep this thing pointed, of course, in a straight line, and that's not very easy. You may remember we covered the original Outrun in the top 10 worst games of all time, and the original Outrun came out as number 1. At the end of each stage, we gain some more music and a live band, again pretty similar to the arcade, and you can get to see your score piling up as we hand out those bonus points, but we won't get to see the changeover until it manages to load the next level from the disc. And this race is in a number of stages all across America, and off the top of my head, I'm not quite sure how many. So let's just choose another upgrade, and everybody always chooses the better tyres at the first upgrade stage. I don't know anybody who buys the turbo or the engine, because the tyres are necessary just to keep this thing on the road. Moving on to the city, we encounter a night stage, and that's just an excuse for the authors to reduce the colour palette and add lots of black and grey, and even with this reduced colour palette, the frame rate still stinks, and it looks like it's running on 8 frames per second, which is what we got from Boogie Boy. But still, even at full turbo, this thing is only just playable, and these great multicoloured graphics hide the fact that there is a pretty shoddy track engine at the heart of this game. And the current score for Turbo Outrun is 50% on the Lemon Amiga website. Arriving at number 47, we have Overlander, developed by PMS Systems and released by Elite in 1989. start, we can choose which mission we want to progress through, and of course the higher value missions will be more dangerous, and of course we have to buy ourselves a few things before we start, and those upgrades are very handy in this game, although I'm not quite sure whether you need to press a key to access those. And we start off with a normal chain gun. We can also buy ourselves extra turbo, you can see, and other little things like that. So when we are happy with our upgrades, and again I'm not quite sure what key to press to activate those, we'll start off the game. And unlike Turbo Outrun, we'll find a very smooth frame rate game engine, and you can see there is no loading involved with this game. It's a continuous road, and we will fire healthy leather all the way down it. Of course, this being the future, the sides of the roads are littered with machine gun nests, and you have to destroy those before you go through those roadblocks, otherwise you'll get blown up. And it's a great graphical display, a great dash, which shows us our rev counter and our speed. And it's also great that this frame rate is non-stop, and reminds me of the great American cross-country road race on the Commodore 64. And there isn't much to be said about these graphics. Yes, they're pretty red and brown, as all good futuristic future games tend to be, but that sun never rises or sets either. The problem with this game is there is a lot of traffic on the road. The road isn't very hard to negotiate, but all this traffic will actually slow us down, and it's actually very hard in the later stages with barriers and bombs and things like that blowing us up to keep going. This early stage, it can be argued that the opposite is true, and that it is way too easy and slightly boring as well. But this game does progress for a long time, and you can see we are taking out trucks as well. There are different vehicles on this level. This game tends to run in two ways. There is the slow mode and there is the ultra quick mode, and as soon as you step into ultra quick mode, you will collide with these barriers even before you've even seen those in the road, and that means dodging out of those means you can collide into trees and that kind of thing. So this is no Spy Hunter, but it's better than Combo Racer 3D and lots of other games that we won't be viewing in this top 50 guide. Yes, we won't be seeing Ferrari Formula 1 or Road Blasters, but I feel this game is slightly better than the conversion of Road Blasters that we got on the Amiga, mainly because at least this game is controllable and it moves at least twice as quickly. Current score for Overlander is 53% on the Lemon Amiga database, and I think even though it's kind of a fun game, it is also very annoying as well. Number 46, we have Big Run, developed by The Sales Curve and released on their Storm level in 1992. Yet again, this is an arcade conversion, and it's a pretty loose arcade conversion. In Big Run, we participate perhaps in the Paris to Dakar rally, and we cross deserts and wide cacti and more sagebrush bushes and that kind of thing. Or in this game, we have to do it in Africa against a number of other competitors. This game also runs at lightning speed, and even though the controls aren't amazing, it still handles better than Overlander, and you can see there are various light effects going on as we cross various parts of the desert. And light effects of any description are great in an Amiga game, and you can see a lady walking across the screen almost like Turbo Outrun, and she will have various animations depending on how well we do in the race. If we do great, she'll throw her arms around us, and if we don't, she'll probably run off screaming. Like Overlander, we're probably moving too quickly to be able to avoid things, and crashing out into these things isn't hard. Sometimes you'll just crash out from sheer frustration, and put big rocks in the middle of a racetrack. Not even the Paris to Dakar rally forces us to collide into rocks at high speed, but in this game you certainly do.
Checkpoint.
Even the guy that says checkpoint seems a little bored. Checkpoint! And almost like the guy couldn't even be bothered to voice over this game. You can see some great smoke effects pouring out of the back of our vehicle, and again, as the day to night changes, you'll see changes in the colour scheme, and it's always great to see those little touches, although driving on this banded road reminds me a little bit of worse games, which have to use this really dire banded road mechanism, and they could have made a proper road if they tried. I apologise for the screen flickering, and I didn't realise that the screen would be flickering when I ripped this. That might be an emulator problem or a screen ripper problem, but that does not hide the fact that this game is very shallow. It is possible to complete this very quickly without much practice, and as long as the player gets to memorise where all the hazards are, it's not too difficult, and as long as they can progress into first position, then that's not so bad. But you might have seen we'd had to do this special stage all over again because we didn't make the checkpoint in the ranked order, and I think you have to be in the top three to qualify for the next level, and you can see that the graphics are absolutely nothing to write home about, and neither is the gameplay. We gained an extended time. It's also a pity that the collision detection is broken, and you can see we drove straight under that tree, but apparently we still hit that hitbox, and that doesn't make this game very friendly to advanced racers. Big Run currently has a score of 55% on the Lemon Amiga database, and I think it is very deserving of that score.